This evening, I want to invite your attention to the book of Matthew just for a little while. Matthew's chapter 9. And let's look at verses number Matthew 9, verses 27 through 31. Matthew's chapter 9, verses 27 through 31. Let's read on the 35 if I make it there, but anyway, 9 through 35. And it read as, "And when Jesus departed thence, two blind men followed him, crying and saying, Thou son of David, have mercy on us. And when he was come into the house, the blind men came to him, and Jesus said unto them, Believe ye that I am able to do this? They said unto him, Yea, Lord. Then touch ye their eyes, saying, According to your faith, be it unto you. And their eyes were opened, and Jesus straightly charged them, saying, See that no man know it. But they, when they were departed, spread it abroad his fame in all the country. As they went out, behold, they brought to him a dumb man possessed with a devil. And when the devil was cast out, the dumb spake, and the multitude marveled, saying, It was never so seen in Israel. But the Pharisees said, He cast out devils through the prince of devils. And Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people." Let's just focus a little while maybe from verse 27 to 31. If we have time, I may elaborate on 32 to 35. But right now, let's look at dealing with these two blind men. We talked this morning, we talked about Jesus' power over many things. He had power over diseases, power over demon, power over destruction, power over death. And this evening, I want to use for subject this evening, Jesus got power over disabilities. And when you look at this, these two men were blind. Can you imagine someone being blind? And the thing about it, if they were blind, evidently, I would think somebody had to lead them to where Jesus was. And when they was blind, they wanted to be healed. I noticed that he called him Son of David. If you look there, he called him Son of David. And if you go back to Matthew's chapter 1, we talked about that in the genealogy of Jesus, where they call him the Son of David. It's a usual name that means that this was the one that was the Messiah that would come. So they trust him. They knew something about Jesus. You see, you can not be able to see anything and be able to hear a whole lot of things. So what surprised me is a little bit, if you will, how they wanted to see, in a sense, and the idea is they was able to see Jesus without sight, but the Pharisees couldn't see Jesus at all. If you use a little irony, if you will, because literally they was blind, but they was able to see the message that Jesus is a healer. Jesus have power. Jesus is the one that's been healing people. And imagine this, if somebody was able to heal somebody and you know that they can heal you, I mean, they may have not had the internet, they may have not had a Facebook, they may have not had all these things we're able to communicate, but somehow they knew and heard about something about Jesus, and they wanted to find Jesus regardless. We want to find Jesus. I don't know the people that took them to where Jesus were. I don't know how they influenced them, but somehow they got to where Jesus was. You see, when you really want to help, or you want to be blessed by something you know that's going on that you have heard, then you're going to make your way there. You're not going to use any excuse whatsoever at all. These men somehow end up where Jesus was. See, when he got where Jesus was, notice what they did when they got where Jesus was, and when they departed thence, two blind men. Evidently, if Jesus had just raised the dead and heard about this ruler that he raised his daughter, can you imagine how the fame starts spreading everywhere and the ideas, and this man may couldn't see, but he heard, I heard about somebody called Jesus, and now y'all take me there. So here, this man here wanted to go, and notice that when he got there, the blind, it was two blind men followed him crying. And when you say crying, that's suggestive. They was hollering out loud. They crying out to Jesus. And maybe they had to holler above the crowd, make sure that Jesus heard. They're not going to say, I'm not ashamed to holler out. Maybe, I don't know how loud they was hollering. Maybe the crowd was there and they had to holler above everybody else. But they cried out loud. And this is what they were saying, crying out, saying, Thou Son of David. They recognized who he was. The Son of David. They're talking about the coming Messiah. And if they knew of the coming Messiah, he would come out of the lineage of David. They recognize him. When you see that phrase, Son of David, or that title, Son of David here. Mm-hmm. Have mercy. They knew that he was a merciful God. We need to know that Jesus is a merciful God. That's the way we need to be, merciful people. And when he was come into the house, the blind men came to him, and Jesus said unto them, Believe that I am able to do this. Now, do you have faith? That's what I was talking about this morning. Mm-hmm. All of these people, they had some faith. Do you believe that I can do it? If they had said, no, we don't believe it, they wouldn't have came. They would have said no. But the idea is they believed it. You may have heard of it, and something gave them, made them believe. And I believe it's here. The Bible tells us when it comes to the gospel, faith cometh by hearing. So evidently, they probably had heard that Jesus had healed somebody. So they had faith, and they believed that Jesus can heal. Can you imagine how their life would be changed? Set for instance today, everything would change. Can you imagine their handicap? Set for instance here, like today, if somebody was handicapped, they would have maybe a special spot, not for them to be driving, but they can probably use a handicapped parking space because if somebody else is driving for them and they have the disability, or they wouldn't need their cane anymore. They wouldn't need the thing. Their whole life would change. They could probably do things they never did before. In fact, if one was blind back then, they rely upon, many of them had to rely upon just standing out by the street, just begging, because they didn't have maybe some of the help that they have, that we have today. They have to ask for help and beg. Can you have a dime, or do you have a quarter, do you have a dollar? And they had a legitimate reason. I don't know, many times people be out there, they say, maybe they just be out there around Walmart, may have more stuff than you, I don't know. But the idea is, they had a legitimate way, and that this was their way of making their living, was to simply beg. So in other words, everything would change about them, because when they was able to see, they would probably have to go and try to provide for themselves and what have you. But this man here was blind, and they wouldn't worry about all that. All I want to do is to be able to see. So here, these men here asked for Jesus' help. Mm-hmm. And notice here what he said in verse number 29. Then touched he the eyes. You know, we talked about the touch, how compassionate Jesus was. Jesus touched a lot of people. He touched the man with the leprosy. He didn't supposed to touch it. According to the Jewish law, he didn't supposed to touch nobody that had leprosy. He touched the woman that had the issue of blood. He didn't supposed to touch. But the idea is, that was a connection with Jesus touching them, coming in contact with them, letting them know that somebody cares. Mm. And he touched them. Touch them, and maybe Jesus didn't have to really touch them to heal their eyes. He could have just spoke the word and just healed them. And I noticed one other passage when you look, I believe in John chapter 9, You remember the blind men there? I think the children talked about it. One of these blind men this morning. The blind man there, he was blind from birth. And could you imagine this man was blind, and they were blind from birth in John chapter 9, and Jesus spit on the ground. Can you imagine somebody saying, "Don't put your spit on me"? This man wasn't worried about no spit. And you know what I really think? He spit on the ground and made some clay. I think he did that because man was made from mud and from dirt. And he spit on him. He probably didn't even have to do that, but he did it to come into. In other words, he put this mud on his eyes. And the idea is, when he put this mud on his eyes, can you imagine people today just rejecting what Jesus do, and right, they the one need to help? So you need to allow whatever Jesus said do. You need to just do it. If he told him to go and wash it off or whatever Jesus said do, just do it. So this man here, in our text tonight, this man here was blind, and they wanted Jesus here. Then it goes on to say here, "Then touch ye their eyes, saying, according to your faith, be it unto you." They had to, they believed in Jesus, their faith. And notice that this repetition of faith kept coming up with all of these people. Faith, faith is what gets you there. Then, verse 30, "And their eyes were opened, and Jesus straightway charged them, saying, see that no man know you." Can you imagine that Jesus commanded, "Don't you go and tell nobody"? But can you imagine something happened to you? And I don't think they were really just trying to disobey God's command, but the excitement. Can you imagine? You have never in your sight, you didn't have sight, and all of a sudden you was in a, and Jesus gave you sight, and now I'm just thinking they were so excited until they just couldn't help to tell somebody, or somebody saw them or whatever. But can you imagine? Jesus commanded them not to tell nobody, but this man can see now, and just like if you get some good news, you're going to tell somebody. Even if you win at the casino, amen, somebody gonna know it. Why? Because there's something you just can't hold. I ain't gonna tell how many people you might tell, but I guarantee you, you're gonna tell somebody. I don't care if you just find $100 on the ground, you're gonna tell somebody. Because good news is something that when something happened to you good, you can't help but to tell somebody. I know back here, a while back, I was in Aceco. I messed around and I dropped a $100 bill. And I said, Jesus, why don't you just go back? They probably, oh, it's gone. It ain't got no name on it or nothing. But just so happened, I just said, let me go back up there. I went back up there and I asked the cashier, "Did y'all find a $100 bill?" And he said, "No." And having the owner or something walked up and said, "Yeah, we did. It was laying right there." And they gave it back to me. It didn't have no name on it. And they don't even know if it was mine or not. But the idea is, it was a good news for me that day, because I had counted a loss.
Right.
But good news. And that's why I'm telling you. You tell good news, don't you? That's why I'm telling it tonight. Good news. Some good things. When something good happened to you, ain't nothing. And you tell it. I'm thinking that's what these men got caught up in. They didn't suppose it. Jesus told you, don't tell nothing. But Jesus tell us today, go and tell everybody, and many of us won't tell. But that don't mean I'm not talking. If you don't, if you tell somebody, I'm not talking to you. But the idea is, we supposed to tell everybody right, the good news, because something good has happened to us. And can you imagine? This man has sight, but our sins have been washed away. And we ought to be telling everybody about how our sins have been washed away. Isn't that something good to tell?
Right.
That's what we got to get excited about. Telling people about how our sins have been washed away, and how we had a Savior that was beat beyond recognition. And the idea is, he was on the cross, he bleeded for us, a story that never grows old. That's the best message we could ever tell us. That's the good news of the gospel. Now, all good news can't save you, but that's the good news that will save you. Now, what do you mean by that? You can go out here on this parking lot and find, if you find $20 bill, that's some good news, but that good news won't save you. And that may not be, but if you could even find, you can even, what did people hit the other day? This million or $1 billion jackpot, you better believe that to them, that was some good news, but that good news can't save you. Jesus' good news, the gospel, is the only good news that can save mankind tonight. And you can, and tonight one could be saved. And really, the good news there is the best news in the world, because that's worth more than all the money in the world, is to have Jesus. And when you leave this world, you know, we're not just going to die and be gone. You're going to have to face judgment. That's what a lot of people think. When I die, I'm just going to be gone. It's more to it than just dying. If we just had to die and never be thought about no more, you know, a lot of us probably wouldn't be here. We wouldn't even worry about it. We'd just be like Rome. We'd be dead. We'd just be dead all over. It's not like that. No. We got to face judgment one time. We got to spend eternal somewhere. Well, it's in heaven or hell. And that's a choice we have to make tonight. Will you live for God, or will you continue, or will one live for Satan? That's a choice. One or the other. There's nobody in between. There's no halfway. You're going to be one or the other. So tonight, I'm inviting you to come to Christ. That's what we need to be, is in Christ. Where we can be, live eternally in heaven. We can go and live with God, and all the ones that are faithful, God will come back and raise up. You can, and that'll be a blessing one day. So why not tonight be with Christ? Hear the gospel, Romans 10:17. Believe with all your heart, Hebrews 11:6. Repent of your sin, Luke 13:3. Confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, Matthew 10:32. And be willing to be baptized, according to Acts 2:38. For Peter preached that first gospel sermon to the foolish. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, for the remission of your sin, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Accept the invitation, my come. While we stand, the same invitation.